Welcome, everyone, to an amazing episode of Inappropriate Earl. I have a co-host with me today, Gail Gramlich. And I have to build up who my guest is. I'm getting my radiator fixed about a week ago on Melrose. Guy said, I got 7 hours. I had time to kill. I start walking down Melrose, got my iPod on. I hit play. It's on shuffle, so it's all random what's coming. The Rat song, Back for More, comes up, and I swear to God, when Robin Crosby's acoustic part starts, I see this restaurant marquee. It says Gardell's. That's the restaurant where the video for Back for More starts. As if those two signs aren't enough. I come home. I log onto my Facebook. I have a lovely message from Brett Baxter Clark. Brett Clark was Nick the Dick in Bachelor Party. God was telling me, you must have Tawny Catane on your podcast. Has God is telling me this. O.J. Simpson is on my TV screen. Orenthal James Simpson. After that, I swear to God, a Whitesnake video comes on.
Stop lying.
And I said, I must get Tawny Catane on. Please put your hands together for Tawny Catane.
Yay. Yay, Tawny Catane. Who I look like.
Right. I'm so grateful.
Oh, do people not?
They do. They do. They pronounce it Tawny Catane.
Tan. No, yes. Catane. No,
listen,
Catane. Yeah,
Tawny Catane.
Chris Catane will never be on this couch.
He said one time in an interview that he wished I was his sister, so that was sweet.
Yeah.
So
here we
close
are.
Enough.
You probably should. Yeah, should just a little closer. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, like you're hosting.
Like you're hosting America's Funniest Videos.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, like I'm. Okay.
Which you did.
I did.
Yeah.
I did with Dave Coulier.
Yeah.
And by the way, thank you so much for that lovely interview.
That's true.
Isn't that wonderful? Is
that
Earl's
really
great.
Happen?
I swear that? On my parents' souls, who I love
really?
Dearly. Back from where starts playing. I look up. And I'm in front of Gardell's. And that's a phone that's going to be turned off instantly. Yeah. And I'm like, oh my. And I start looking into the restaurant like I'm going to see you in there. In your beautiful 50s attire. I mean, you are stunning today.
Thank you.
I love the red, by the way. The last time I saw you, you looked great as a blonde. It was a couple years ago. I met you at the Comedy Store, that's and you great. Looked lovely as a blonde. But when I saw the red, I was like, yeah, she's rocking the red hair again,
thank
which
you.
Is so fun.
Thank
so.
You. I moved to Newport Beach. Like, it's down, people, it's down that way.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of fell into that whole OC housewife thing, where you know, kind of like you need a passport and you have to have blonde hair to get into.
Like Stepford Wives kind of thing.
Horrible.
Yeah.
Absolutely horrible. And then I woke up one day and went, I've got to get back.
Yeah. I like it. I mean, no matter what you do to your hair, it's going to look great.
Thank
for
you.
Real. I mean,
you
have such great hair.
Well, I get a lot of this is that your hair. While their hands are in it. I'm like, can you get your hand out of my hair?
Yeah, that's creepy.
Like people
like
must,
when you're pregnant, they come up and they come up and they just run their fingers through my hair.
But it's so it's so wonderful.
Such a pain in the ass. Yeah.
Oh, you can swear. This is that's why it's called Inappropriate Earl.
Okay.
You can say whatever you want.
Good.
And if there's any questions we ask you don't want to answer,
I can take the fifth.
You can take the fifth.
Yeah.
We don't want too much dirt.
Okay.
I mean,
not.
Well, I mean,
you can be do whatever you want.
Do whatever you want. Whatever I mean, you know, if I ask you how creepy was Stephen Piercy to you, and do you want to protect
kicks.
Him?
Kicks.
I mean,
when he remember?
Well,
that was his move. That was the Stephen Piercy move.
Well, I saw him about 2 months ago at the Whiskey, and those kicks have now they're about ankle level now. And I love Stephen Piercy.
So do I.
He is the voice
good
of Rat.
He looks
his kicks are about ankle high. Now
I saw him from far. I mean, at least he's still in shape.
I mean, I enjoy his voice.
Well, at least he's still in shape.
Yeah, I mean, I could see him from, you know, far.
And I could tell out of all the Rat members, he seems to miss Robin the most.
No, I missed.
I mean, you made Rat.
I thank you.
And I'm serious. Without you in those videos and on the album covers, it's like, oh, this band's just a hard rock band.
Do you know how they got signed?
That's why you're on the show.
Yeah,
because you were a bigger star. But you know, you were in Bachelor Party. I mean, they were lucky to be hanging around you.
Well, thank you. That's very sweet. But you know that Rob was my first boyfriend.
Yes.
He was my first love.
Because you grew up in San Diego. We grew
up in San Diego together. Mm-hmm. And he dreamed about becoming a rock star. And I dreamed about becoming an actress. Mm-hmm. And I got out of there first. And I did what I set out to do. And I was dating at that time a gentleman by the name of Pete Angelus. He was the lighting director at the time, but is the manager of Van Halen.
Oh.
So Rob, I don't, everyone else calls him Robin. No. His name is Rob. And so Rob and the boys moved up and he called me and he said, do you think you could have Pete come see us and give us some advice? Because at that time they were just playing the Troubadour and the Whiskey and, every telephone pole, they were going around with a staple gun and all that stuff. And they weren't signed yet. So Pete went and saw them at Gazzari's, I believe it was.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
And he said, okay, Rob, because Rob was the lead singer at that time. He said, Rob, get off the mic, play guitar. Don't be background singer. And Warren, God, it was so long ago, I forgot, because I used to babysit Warren.
Uh-huh. Wow.
Yeah. And so then Warren somehow got into the band, became the lead guitar player, and Rob is just the rhythm. And Pete helped them get signed to RCA.
Wow. Wow, because I think Warren had replaced Jake E. Lee, who was with Steven.
So, I mean, it was like an orgy. I mean, like all these guys, like Rudy Sarzo.
Right.
What was that?
He was in Quiet Riot.
Then I saw him again in Whitesnake.
Went to Ozzy. He really lucked out.
By the way, Rudy, one of the nicest guys you will ever meet in the rock and roll business.
And wrote a great book. Off the Rails.
Which I love that book. I enjoyed it.
I think I gave it to you.
Yes.
I love that man.
Yeah.
Michael DeBars too.
Oh, Michael DeBars.
Love Michael.
Wow. I mean, we could go on for hours.
We could.
I mean, we're just starting.
Oh, yeah.
My kids, they're like, honey, you don't know anybody. And I'm like, no, honey, your mom knows a few people.
Yeah.
Like, they just think I'm just like this dorky mom.
Oh, my God. No.
And the song will come on, and I'm like 1 degree of separation from somebody.
Right.
Somehow, or I got them together, I did the album cover, and they're just like, Mom, shut up.
I mean, everyone,
enough already, Mom.
Looks at those Rat cut, the EP, which which I read in Stephen Piercy's book that Robin was throwing the rats on your leg
with Neil Slezar,
legendary rock and roll photographer.
Photographer who, by the way, when A&E did a biography on me, they went to him because they had to buy pictures. First of all, I thought, doing a biography on me, I'm not dead yet. Yeah. Why?
Right.
So they went to him, and the pictures were like, he wouldn't sell them for like less than $1,000 a piece.
Right.
And it's an hour show. And they were like, couldn't just buy one picture and narrate over the top of that. So I was like, Neil, let me have these pictures. He has so many pictures of me from just hanging out the Van Halen days. Right. All those years.
I remember seeing a biography just on TV I don't even remember what it was, though. It was a biography on you, but I can't remember what channel it was on.
Oh, that one was complete bullshit, if I can say that.
Oh, please.
It was BS.
Now, did they tell you a different premise? Like, oh, we're going to make, we just want to hear about your lovely life, and then they sandbag you and talk about, some bad things?
Well, yes and no. That's why it took me so long to approve the A&E biography. E was like, we're going to do this with you or without you. And when they say that, you know that's what they're going to do.
Right.
So I just went, then I'm not going to have anything to do with it.
Oh, my God.
And then it's just.
So they just go ahead and write about you and they get away with it?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
And paint you as probably this, you know, bimbo, you know, with rockers and then of course, you're not that. You're much more than that.
Yeah. No, they didn't paint me like that because I do have my own body of work.
Mm-hmm.
No, they just painted me. It was mostly from my divorce, which the only thing that wasn't in your introduction was that you tripped over a baseball.
Well, I was
gonna,
I was gonna say I didn't want to go too over the top that I did have a Chuck Finley jersey on walking down Melrose.
He probably did.
Would not be true.
Number 46.
Number 31.
31, 40. Well, you know, shows you what a liar I am. I should just stick to the rat material.
Go with what you know.
Earl, go with what you know. Yeah. And if you don't, ask me.
Yeah.
Gail and I, we're women. We have all the answers.
Yes, that's true.
I know. That's why, you know,
I'm here.
The two loves of my life are in, you know, in my couch right now.
Yeah, see?
And Lois.
Yeah, and our little angel.
Who is not like that with everybody.
Yeah, yeah. Very comfortable.
I was going to say, is adoption possible?
Yeah.
It's possible.
To my little... For the right price.
For the right price. I'm not Neil Zolzauer.
Yeah.
You can have her for $1,000. Take a picture.
I object. Yeah, I get her suit. She's so my angel, sweet. Too.
So you knew Van Halen.
Yes.
As they were rising, I guess.
Yes, I did. I toured. David and Pete and I, we were the three amigos. He lived with us. He slept on our couch. I will not go into detail about the things David used to do.
Can you just give us one?
I can't.
Wow.
I really can't. Maybe one day.
No.
I can't.
You'll be back
from... What if we guess? Can we guess?
It has nothing to do with...
Oh, okay. Of course.
Oh, no. We're just talking about, like, he's on your couch, right?
He's sleeping on your couch.
And every night you wake up in the morning and he's naked. You wake up in the morning and there's girls. You wake up in the morning. Okay.
Midgets.
You wake...
bodybuilders.
Wake up in the...
But I will tell you this.
Okay.
One time we went to the Caribbean. Because one thing about being in a band, like I was in a band...
You were a big part of the whole scene.
Seattle fan, member, you know.
Oh, absolutely.
Right. So when you're on tour, you want to be on vacation, and when you're on vacation, you want to be touring.
Right.
Or when you're making an album, you want to be touring. When you're touring, you want to make an album. All that. So we were in the Caribbean in between tours, and we were going through customs, and on the other side. David goes, give me your purse. And I gave him my purse. And I go, why? He goes, I got to get my pot.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, what?
Right.
He put his stash in my purse through customs because I was this sweet little innocent thing. And he knew they weren't going to check me.
Well, of course. That's very nice of Diamond Dave.
Isn't that nice of Diamond Dave?
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, that was funny.
But it's pretty funny smart. Now. Yeah.
That's now, did crazy. You?
My kids coming home and telling me that. I'm going, sure. Your friend put it in your purse.
Yeah.
Do your kids know who David Lee Roth, Van Halen, do they know who Rat is? Or
I'm sure they do, but they don't associate me with any of it because I really am their mom. Like, I'm not even a human being.
Right.
I took a picture and I put it on Instagram and it was kind of sexy, I guess. I don't know if it can be at my age, but it was kind of sexy.
Oh,
it can be.
It can be. Yeah.
I'll take that from you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
So my daughter had a complete meltdown. You're a mother.
Right.
Why are you posting that? And I was like, I'm your mom, but I'm also a part of the world. Like, there are people who know your mom. and they kind of want, maybe might want to see that picture.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
But I had to take it down.
Really?
She begged me. Nobody wants to see that, mom. And you
yes,
couldn't even
they do.
See.
Yes, they do.
And believe me, they do.
And I think keep going and keep, I mean, not as go crazy or whatever, but let people know what you're up to, because people want to know what you're up to and they want to see you doing well,
if I
feeling
give you my
well.
Kids' phone numbers, will you call them and
absolutely
tell them?
I will call them.
Listen, Earl, it's to the point that, I mean, look at, I mean, underneath this.
You look great.
Thanks, but I dress like I'm, you know.
Well, you
because my kids, they're completely.
But you can't
out.
Be doing the splits on Jaguars in front of your kids.
I still can, though.
Oh, that's awesome.
I can rent two Jaguars for the next show.
Well, my age, it should probably be a Cadillac now or something.
Well, why don't we start off with like a Kia and then we'll just.
Or a smart car.
I mean, you look stunning.
Thank you.
And I'm not like.
I'm swallowed up in this couch. Thank you.
I mean, I had the biggest crush on you after I saw Bachelor Party. I mean, just, you know, you were, are beautiful. I mean, that was such a great movie. I think it's the best comedy from the
80s.
Yeah. Cute.
That made me want to do, Tom Hanks made me want to do comedy. Just, I know that he wasn't a comedian then, but he was so funny that he was one of my first inspirations. And that movie was so, it was just so great and so silly and so funny. And we do know Nick the Dick. That's like our buddy. That's like our bud. It's just, I don't know. It was great.
And he's so nice.
Yeah, he's really cool. Yeah, talks. He's a talker.
He's a nice guy.
Doesn't have a lot of lines in that movie, but.
But he had the line.
Yeah, the
Nick
line.
Nick the what?
Nick the Dick. Dick.
That was so much fun filming that.
No, that was filmed. That one scene, was that at the Chippendales on Overland?
Yes.
Why I know that. Which is now a grade school.
Yeah. Time.
Which is the craziest thing. It's a great preschool.
Wow.
Now they have Chippendales at nightclubs.
He was tall, really good. He like intimidated me.
Yeah.
He was so tall and good looking. I didn't know what guys with really intense, like good bodies look like, I guess. I mean, Rob, don't get me wrong. He's
beautiful.
A god.
I mean,
god.
I would say.
Imagine I was 16 years old, and I saw him at a dance, and I went. I mean, like the world stopped.
Yeah.
Like I don't remember what I had for lunch yesterday, but I will never forget the first time I met him.
Yeah.
I mean, he was. You guys, outside of me and Gail, now I'm a little partial, are the best looking couple I've ever seen. I mean, if you guys had kids. They would have been models.
That was one of the last things that he said to me before he died. He said that he wished we would have had children.
Right.
How long were you with him?
Oh, boy. How long was I with him?
Yeah, like you met him 16, at 16.
17, 18,
right.
19. Moved up to LA. I had to. I met Pete, you know, you guys know when you're young and in love and you've never really been there before. So you break up and you get back together and break up. I was, as I was driving here today, I thought, I wish he was, well, I always think that I wish he was here, but he'd be that one guy that I would constantly go back to to this day.
Yeah.
And I miss him every day.
Oh, I mean, he's... Now, was it like... And I don't want to talk about anything bad, but like you were kind of popping as an actress. He was, you know, Rat was at that time...
Blowing up.
Very successful. Yeah. Was it just hard to, you know, maintain a relationship with two people?
No, because by the time they really came onto the scene, I was with David at that point.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So... I remember David and I presented an award at the MTV Awards, and I get up there and I look out into the audience, and there's Rob sitting there. He got married. He was married for like 3 days, I think, to
a playmate. Right.
I think that's like a.
It's a requirement.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I would if I were having him.
And I just remember, my head just went down. I just felt because Whitesnake was doing so, I mean, they were
Yeah.
Thanks to you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I really mean that.
I do
you
too.
Take you out of those videos and it's good music. It's a Britney Fox video with just, you know, better musicianship.
I do like the three keyboards at once. That was a nice intro.
They weren't fucking around. And three keyboards
at once. Artie Kollner does not fuck around.
Yeah.
No,
an amazing director.
Yeah.
But I mean, I didn't know if three keyboards were necessary playing the same line. But that's what made the 80s great. It's like, let's just have three keyboard players.
Yeah, yeah. The extravagance.
Let's have Tommy Aldridge on the drum kit. I mean,
let's take Tommy Lee and spin him around.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was insane.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But the 80s videos are, well, we'll get to Tommy Lee in a second. No, we don't want any dirt.
Speaking of Motley Crue, the first time I ever saw them, I was up on top of Neil Slowsour's rooftop, and it was a party for Van Halen, and there were these four little boys standing in the corner, so shy, and they wanted to come up and meet Eddie and David so bad,
right?
And I look back and I'm like, oh my god, that was Neil, that was Vince,
yeah,
it was Tommy
and Mick. Yeah. I mean, Mick was old then.
Yeah, Mick was old then.
Now he's
rest in peace, definitely. Those things that they signed.
That's tough to
the glasses on.
I mean, I saw them open up for
nice
Kiss.
Nice guy though.
Oh,
nice,
yeah.
Nice guy.
I mean, he's just kind of frail looking.
Yeah.
Like, it sucks for me to see my 80s heroes.
Right?
Like Kiss is
now we know how our parents felt about Frank Sinatra and all those guys.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, I mean, it's like, but Frank looked pretty good. Even toward the end.
Yeah.
Cary Grant. I mean, Paul Stanley.
You rock the long hair, really, when you're 80.
Yeah.
75. Although, Mick Jagger.
He looks good.
He looks great. Yeah.
Keith Richards.
I watched that Beatles thing. I know this is not rock. It's not like rock music, but I still was looking at their hair and I was amazed at how nice their hair looked for their ages. I'm just saying.
Like, I mean, Paul McCartney looks pretty good.
Yeah.
Great.
He has good hair. He doesn't even really have any gray in his hair, and I'm sure he dyes it, but didn't look like he even dyed it. You know, dyed hair. We all dye our hair. You know, but there's something that you can take now, like, to make your hair just grow in the color that it's supposed to be.
Really?
I think that's what Paul McCartney's doing, because I was looking at it, really.
And it grows your hair.
Your natural hair color back. It's like a pill that you can take that makes your hair grow in, because there's something that you lose
for eyelashes.
No, there's just like a pill. It's just something that you're losing when as you age, and that's why your hair goes gray, and it's something that kind of gives that back.
Wow,
look it up. It's called, like,
I think it's Zoloft. So you're so high,
no, it's not.
You don't see your gray hair.
No, it's called something. Just Google pill gray,
just
whatever. Google. I'm telling you,
just
it's a
for
pill.
Women.
You can take it and make sure. I swear, I know that's what Paul McCartney's doing, because his hair looks so natural, and it barely has any gray in it. And I was like, he's taking that pill, and he's taking the best of it, like whatever product. It's the best of the best.
Well, I'm sure he's a Beatle.
He's a Beatle.
He got his music back from Michael Jackson, and he went, I'm going to buy the best pills from my
He had the money again.
You know what? I didn't even know he did that. So now
did
I'm hoping
really
that.
Did you hear that, Gil?
I didn't know that he bought he got the music back. But what I want to see is it on the internet. Like, when you go to bars and stuff and you go to download the music that you want to hear, you can't get any. You ever like go to the jukebox and do the thing and you can hear anything you want? Well, you can't do that with the Beatles. There are like four Beatles songs, and there are just times when I want to rock out to the Beatles, especially when I'm closing. I want to hear something peppy, but not too overbearing. The Beatles is nice.
Yeah,
not Beatles that we're going to talk about.
Too.
Yeah, it is good.
Or Rat.
I mean, we're talking, of course.
Rat. Yeah, but
Back for More. Love Back for More. It really is one of my favorite songs.
It holds up today.
Yeah,
it does.
Yeah.
You know, I stopped listening to music for a long time because of what I had said earlier about how I had a root in something to every song that came on.
Mm-hmm.
And it made me very sad after Rob died. So I stopped listening to music, and I would only listen to KFI 640.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And what did they do? The jingle.
Round and round.
the commercials is wrecked.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
And I just went, oh my God.
You can't even listen to news radio.
News radio.
That's some heavy stuff. I understand that too. This is totally different. Mike, when I lost one of my cats, I was so depressed. No, this sounds crazy, but I was so depressed that I couldn't listen to music for a while. Right. Like, I couldn't listen to anything for like 4 months. I couldn't listen to music, but that's my cat who I loved. Right. So I understand that. Right. Just hearing someone say I couldn't listen to music, right. That makes, and this is so much bigger than
well,
you know.
It's the same thing.
Yeah, it's just loss.
It's the little differences is that happens to be, like that's the cat, you know? That's the person. Mm-hmm. And it is tough. And when you associate your life with music and you know, like when I think about writing a book, I know I'm going to have to listen to these songs. It'll jar my memory of things that I don't regularly think about.
Yeah. So that you stuffed away.
So I totally understand that about your cat.
Yeah. Thanks. It was a while. I'm okay. But I just went through a period where I couldn't.
Oh, I mean, with animals. I've cried more putting my dogs down than I did when my parents passed. It just, I don't know what that says about me as
Bring
a person.
Stuff
but
up. Right. Just, that's what just, I think.
Because they're so dependent on you.
Yeah.
Right.
But like when Robin passed, like I've heard like, and he's my idol, even though I don't play music. I just,
he was so cool.
Yeah. He just
was just the epitome of cool.
Mm-hmm.
He was the antithesis. I mean, he was born with it.
He was a star.
He was it.
And nothing against the other guys from Rat, but
nothing. I mean,
looks wise.
Aside,
you know,
everybody aside,
Bobby Blotzer, not you know, great drummer.
Warren was good looking.
Warren was good. Juan was, you know, he kind of looked like a white Rick James with the Jerry curl. But Steven,
good looking guy.
Paul Stanley, kind of clonish. Right.
I never thought of that.
Well, you could tell he was very influenced by Paul.
What? The picture of Steven does remind me of Paul.
And you know, when I went to the book signing, he was very nice to me, although I don't think he should be doing 11 in the morning book signings. He was a little rough.
11 in the morning, these guys never saw.
No, and he was there. He was there and his body was there, but I'm not sure if his brain was there. But, I mean, Robin just stood out. It, really among, maybe Bon Jovi was about the only other guy who was like, wow, this guy's good looking. So, and I'm as straight as a pole, but...
His Rob's birthday is August 4th and mine's August 5th.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, we were soulmates.
Mm.
But I mean, like, you hear varying reports, like when he passed, like he was somewhat alone, like his band kind of, to a degree, abandoned him. Was he alone or was he?
Well, he was with, physically right there?
Well, did he have friends? Were friends helping him or did you just kind of?
I was with him the last 3 months of his life.
Right.
And he was between Cedar Sinai and a rest home because unfortunately his disease, unlike Matthew McConaughey's character, he blew up.
Mm-hmm. Right, right.
And so
I just saw that movie.
The beds, they couldn't really hold him. So he was on La Brea, at a rest home in La Brea, and I would drive up and see him every week. And he asked me to go get him peppermint schnapps and bring it to him.
Right.
And I'm like, absolutely.
Yeah.
Like, maybe someone else would say, don't do it.
Yeah.
And people were saying, don't do it. But he knew he didn't have long. We all knew he didn't have long.
Right.
And this is what he wanted. Mm-hmm. I mean, I wasn't going to say no. So I bring him 2 bottles of peppermint schnapps and he would, that was his. And then he checked himself out.
Right.
And then he checked himself out.
Right. Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's just neat to see still the love in your eyes for him. And like, I don't want to, we're not trying to make you sad. I just, you know, it's just neat to hear you as icon from that era and beyond, not just that, you know, 80s. And it's just neat to see like love, you know. And so when he you know, you're with David. Mm-hmm. The White Snake blows up. Did you see? I mean, like, what's it like? Like, you were with them before they blew up, and I mean, is there a point in time when you're like, "Wow, this video is a hit," and then you just realize this is going to be huge?
Yes, our first date. He picked me up in the white Jaguar.
Oh wow!
And he put in a cassette, and he said, "This is the album that I'm trying to release." And I just rolled down the window and put my arm on the window and just went, "Oh my God, this guy thinks he's a rock star." Another guy who thinks he's a rock star. Like, when is this going to stop?
Right.
The car broke down in the middle of Santa Monica and La Cienega. He was in a blue suit and he got out and he had to push the Jag to the side to the curb. That was our first date.
Oh my God.
And I went, "This guy's not a rock star. He's not going to be a rock star."
What was the song?
If
you can remember.
Still of the Night?
That's a good song, though.
Wow.
It had to have been one of those but they weren't.
That was the first video you were in of theirs, right? Wasn't Still of the Night was the first one. Yeah.
But yes.
And that was a great video, but the one that really took off was the
Here I Go Again.
You know, the green suit with the hair, and
that was the blue suit.
Oh, was that? No, he was in a blue suit.
Yes.
Did he wear that same blue suit on your first date? Oh my God, that is so funny.
He was in debt to Geffen at the tune of $2 million.
Wow.
At that point. So I got him at a great time. Yeah. He had lost money. He had already been a drug addict. So there was no drugs, no drinking. Everyone associates me with, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Mm-hmm. No, there was sex because I was married.
Right.
And there were no drugs. And mm-hmm. Rob did not do drugs until rap became...
Right. So they had the money
I was living with Nikki in the valley, mm-hmm. and him and Nikki.
Nikki Six?
Yeah.
I mean, I can't imagine those two being roommates.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
The mayhem.
Oh, yeah.
So through my entire life, I would always see him. I'd always go to his house. We'd always meet. So I saw him at every place, and I'd go visit him when he lived with Nikki. And they were crazy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
there became a point where I couldn't date him anymore, but I loved him, you know?
Wow.
I mean, it was just like his thirst for women was mm-hmm. just, you know.
Nikki or Robin, or both.
Both, and paired together, they were just like your biggest nightmare.
Yeah, yeah.
Or your best dream, you know, however, it was a nightmare as far as I was concerned, but they loved it.
And then you throw in Vince Neil in the mix.
Yeah. Well, you throw in Tommy.
Vince. I mean,
I love Vince, but he got lucky on that one.
Well, yeah, I mean, Mick probably did okay. He probably got the leftovers.
It was Tommy was the one who was liking the girls, and Nikki Six was all about drugs. That's what I remember.
When you think about them, just surfacely for the first 3 seconds, that's where you would go. Nikki, drugs.
Yeah.
Tommy, women.
Yeah.
Vince.
Booze and women.
Women and
drugs.
Well, yeah. I mean, the Razzle from Hanoi Rocks.
Yes.
Which is crazy that he served 30 days.
Crazy, because today.
Oh, yeah.
Are you kidding me?
20 years.
He got a slap on the wrist mm-hmm. for that.
And still would continue to drive drunk.
And still continue. Yeah.
I mean, that's, another part of that
Allegedly.
Era.
Allegedly.
Yeah.
Oh, of course. If Vince Neil's lawyer is listening to this, I do not consent to you listening. I mean, it was such a crazy era.
It was. And can you imagine? I didn't drink or do drugs. And everybody, they look at me and they go, mm-hmm. "Oh, you must have been doing drugs." I got all the guys all my boyfriends, I got them at the right times.
Well, speaking of boyfriends and right times,
mm-hmm.
If you don't want to talk about this particular person, cool.
If it's the person who I think you're going to bring up, I don't want to talk about it.
a football player.
Right.
No problem. No problem. I'm just saying you got him at the right time.
Yes.
So we'll leave it at that.
Yes.
Yeah.
We won't say his name.
Okay.
But if you're in Florida, they have great orange juice. So back to what?
Pretend that I don't even
know. No, absolutely. Like I said, we love you so much. We want to be respectful. He was my neighbor, so that's just another.
Did you live in Brentwood?
I grew up in Bel Air, and this podcast is not about my upbringing. But Stallone and Kareem and OJ lived in.
Yeah.
Dinner that would be.
Oh, absolutely. And he threw me the football as a kid.
Nice. That's not even good.
Okay. So David Coverdale, broken down car, La Cienega, Santa Monica, White Snake, the videos. Well, let's get to Bachelor Party for a second.
Okay. Yeah.
As you can.
Career.
Yeah. But you're more just, you know, Rob's.
Winter, rainy. Those are my daughters.
Yes. I saw that.
From Mr. Finley.
By the way, great names.
Yes, Mr. Finley.
Yeah.
Now, Bachelor Party, you guys were not the original two. It was
choices.
Paul Reiser.
I screen tested with Paul.
And how it did
and
it?
I got the part, and I show up at work, and there's Tom Hanks.
Wow!
And did you know who he was? Because he was fairly unknown
Bosom
at that
Buddies.
Time.
He had already done
Bosom Buddies.
That movie with
Money Pit,
Blonde, No Electricity,
Splash.
Yes, he'd already done Splash.
Daryl Hannah, and John Candy, and
right,
yeah.
So he had already done that, but. No, I didn't really know who he was.
Did he get the job without you screen testing with them? They just liked him?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Yes. Yeah. They saw Splash and they tested. Oh, I tested with Tim, with Jeff Conaway too.
Kaneki from Greece.
Yeah.
Right.
And Taxi.
Taxi.
Yeah.
Who unfortunately passed.
He
was in the Dodger.
A couple years ago.
Yeah. No, he was sad.
And that's when I was on that show, and I was the only one who wasn't doing anything.
Yeah.
So you put Rock and Roll together and Celebrity Rehab, and you go, oh, okay.
And The Surreal Life, which I wanted to talk about too. But you know what? It was so cool. And we'll get back to Bachelor Party. The reason why I watched it, I never watched that show ever, but my girlfriend was bedridden because she was pregnant and she needed to just be in bed. It was like one of those things. And it was a Sunday and we were just kicking it. And they had season 6 of The Surreal Life on all day. And I was just like, oh, they have Tawny. Let's watch it. And we just sat there and watched back to back episodes. So interesting though. And the only thing I have to say is I remember Florence Henderson being so mean to you. She was. And I was like,
Thank
she's really
you.
going at her. Like, going for the throat on Tawny, and I didn't get it. I think she was just mad because you were a bit, you were the big splash on that season. I mean, there was
CeCe DeVille.
Yeah, CeCe, and that he was sweet.
Another icon.
I could see like who was cool and who wasn't, and she was just a bitch, and she was coming for you. And even you were being so nice to her, and she was still being so mean. She just did not like you.
Yeah.
So
I love you so much.
Yeah,
thank you. For noticing
no problem.
That, because everybody thinks, oh, Mrs. Brady, the nicest woman in the world.
No.
And she was so mean.
Mean. And you guys made a video and like you dressed up like a nun and she was like, I was raised by nuns.
Yes.
And you're like, I'm a nun. I'm not doing naked things. I'm doing anything crazy. I'm in a nun outfit and you're upset about that too. Like
she thought I was being too sexy.
Yeah.
And she was,
you're making a video.
But even you could be sexy as an immigrant field worker. I mean,
that's my next role.
Well, listen, I'll write it. Me and Gail will write it.
Okay.
And, maybe a sequel to Bachelor Party.
Yeah.
You know, sequels.
That would be
cool. So they wanted to do a sequel. But it was back in the day when if you did a sequel, you were a loser.
Right.
And now actors don't even want to get into a film unless there's a sequel, franchise.
Oh, yeah. For sure.
So, we got an offer to do a second Bachelor Party and it was like, no.
Well, I think they did a really bad kind of a loose sequel with Gary Busey's kid. Jake Busey.
Oh. Hangover.
Yeah. it was like, I think it was called like Bachelor Party in Vegas and it didn't
seriously?
I think it went straight to Laserdisc.
Oh,
and
I didn't even hear anything about that.
It didn't,
Gary Busey's son is an actor?
He's done a few things. I think he got into music after the acting kind of somewhat fizzled out for him. And nice guy.
Wasn't Gary Busey in The Surreal Life too?
I don't even call myself sober because I don't do anything.
Yeah.
Right.
I had a stint for a good 6 months on something once.
It's all good.
Yeah, yeah. Right. It's okay. But, I was not taking anything and all these people around me are jonesing off of medication and you couldn't tell if Gary was coming off of anything or if that's how he really was. But what an interesting character. I mean, some of the things that he says would make you stop and think.
Mm-hmm. Right.
He did that on Celebrity Apprentice where he would, you know.
Yeah, he's like a demented genius almost.
Yeah,
like,
that's exactly it.
Like he plays this.
So you have to kind of stop sometimes and wonder, is that crazy or is that the genius?
Yeah.
Are you doing shtick or are you?
He would do these acronym things, right?
Yes.
And he did that on Celebrity Apprentice, and that's why he didn't do very well in the challenges, but they kept him on because he was intriguing. You know, you could tell like the people around are like, why is Gary still here? Like the people that are competing against him were like, why is he still here? But he was so intriguing. I know the producers are just like, we got to keep him on for a little bit longer because.
You mean like a train wreck?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Just interesting to watch. And plus he pissed people off, you know, just.
Well, he has great TV. Yeah. I mean, he's just this almost like a crazy uncle. He's just like, I have to watch this.
Yeah.
You know, because they, you know. On those type of shows, as you know, they pair you up with someone who's like your opposite, so there's conflict, and you know, like you and Florence Henderson.
I was going to say The Surreal Life really gave me, and you have to remember that was all during the time when the writers were on strike, so there was no work at all.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So these shows came around, and you know there was Favored Nations, but you bust through that, and. As long as you got paid more than Favored Nations, you could do it. And I did. And do I regret it? Yes. I regret The Surreal Life. Mm-hmm.
Just because of the product.
The editing.
Right.
I mean, it was crazy stupid how they put that together and made everybody. But the relationship between Florence and I was seriously like that.
She
was so mean.
She's mean. And my whole image of her, the whole way I ever thought of her just changed after that. And I just.
Thank you.
Because she seemed like a nice, you know, she's Mrs. Brady.
Yes, we saw her every Friday night.
Yeah. And she's just not nice. She's not.
And there was Sherman Hemsley, I think, was.
That's right.
And the playmate, wasn't there another blonde, Andrea Lowell? Or was that another, wasn't there another like pretty girl?
I was fixated on Tawny. I'm sorry.
Well, I was fixated. Oh, no, there is no other girl other than Tawny. But I mean, I was fixated on Cece as well. But because he was nice to me when I met him.
No, he's nice. And I never met him. Well, I know. I think I met him at the improv once on one of those rock and roll shows that what's his name does.
Some idiot from.
Yeah. He played for.
Saigon Kick. The drummer got into comedy for a little bit. Now he's into porn. And
yeah.
Gosh, my kids would really stop me at that point.
Yeah.
No, well, I mean, you're not the idiot drummer from Saigon Kick. But I mean, Cece, I met him at Mel's. I think this is probably encaptures him. I saw him. I went up to him. I said, hey, I loved your cover of Grand Funk Railroads. We're an American band. And he's like, well, how'd you get that? It's not out yet. And I'm like, listen, I'm not going to lie to you. I illegally downloaded it. And I went to give him $1. And he's like, that's how I get all my music too. So it was just cool. So like, you know, Gene Simmons probably would have taken the $1.
No,
we're not going to talk about Gene.
20,000 girls.
Oh.
I don't believe his numbers because he lies. You know, he says Kiss sold all these platinum albums. They shipped platinum. They didn't sell.
Right.
I mean, I'm Jewish. I know the deal.
So am I.
Oh, Lahaim.
I always get funny. Don't look at it.
Tony, what are you doing out of the park? No, I'm just kidding. I mean, I'm assuming you've had interactions with Gene. I don't mean, and is he is. I think he thinks he's a lot smarter than he is.
He, I was waiting for David on La Cienega again at a record studio. I was going to pick him up, and so I'm parked. And I see Gene. He sees me. He waves. He strolls up to my car. I roll down the windows. He puts his arms like this. He's like, hey, Johnny.
Ugh.
What's up? What are you doing? And asked me out. And I was like, Gene, you know I'm dating David. Right. Like, but that was Gene, yeah. You know?
Right. I mean,
that's exactly who he was.
Yeah.
It was probably car to car. It wasn't even right. That it was me. Yeah. It was, you know, there happened to be a female in the within his 3 mile radius or 10 feet, actually.
Well, yeah, I mean, 20,000 women. I don't know if I, you know, he's got Polaroids. I mean, what creepy guy takes Polaroids?
And who, if you're the lead singer of Kiss, like, why do you even have to say, we know you've slept with a lot, you know, the world knows that you've slept with a lot of people. Why do you have to give that number?
Because like, he's ego.
Isn't performing in front of 80,000 people enough?
No, not for Gene. He wants to make money.
That's what Gene wants to do.
Kiss condoms, kiss, which is the most macabre. I mean, if you're a man, and neither of you are, and you put on a Kiss condom and you see Gene's.
Or no, if you're a girl.
Right.
Yeah.
And a guy, yeah, no.
And you see Gene's tongue on the tip of this guy's
is
peepee.
That what it
yeah,
is?
I bought one. I bought the Paul Stanley one.
He did it for the jokes.
I mean,
or did you? I think. Did you wear it?
Like a light bulb went off.
Yeah, well, I never saw that condom. Yeah. Me and Gail had a tremendous amount of trust. But
yes.
I mean, Kiss is out. Like, now, Whitesnake and Kiss had problems with each other. Gene, I don't think David was a fan of them. And
well, they're both huge egos.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Huge.
Yeah.
Huge egos. So you... Those kind of egos can't be in the same room together.
Well, it had to kill Gene, like, you know, 87, you know, through, say, 90. Whitesnake was...
86, 87, 88.
Maybe outside of Bon Jovi, the biggest, or with Bon Jovi. And Kiss was kind of struggling, you know,
Yes, because we were them. I was them for Halloween when I was in seventh grade.
Yeah.
I was 12. So... I'm now in my 20s. I'm now.
You look great for
27. And Whitesnake, 80, you know, so that
huge.
Was the 70s.
Yeah.
And then the 8, yeah, they had to have been.
I mean, that had to kill Gene to see these younger bands or you know, just.
Plus Motley was with Doc. My,
yeah.
So Doc had Motley, Bon Jovi, and Kiss.
And I think Cinderella as well.
Uh-huh.
Who I'm a huge fan of, but that's. Their drummer had the best quote ever.
What did he say?
Fred Curry.
Uh-huh. We toured with them a little bit.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And they said, Fred, what are your career goals? And this is when they were kind of had their little run. And he's like, I just want to be good enough to play on the albums.
Wow.
Which totally blew my mind.
That's
like,
really.
What
that's
do you mean?
A great quote.
Like, you don't. That blew my image of like.
What a rock star is.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Whitesnake were fantastic musicians, yes. So they played on their own albums.
Yes, they did.
For the most part. Please don't tell me they didn't.
No, they did. Well, the band that toured, I know John Sykes didn't tour.
And Steve Vai came in.
Steve Vai came in and he didn't. The second album, Slip of the Tongue.
With Deeper the Love. With
Deeper the Love, which was
which my I favorite love video. That song.
My favorite video is that one.
Because it's. I just love that song.
Yeah, because it's oh God, not to, it's deep.
It's deep. Deeper than Love is deep.
It's deep. David has, I think, the best rock voice. He has the best voice.
Yeah, I mean.
Acoustically, anything. Mm-hmm.
I mean, he was in Deep Purple, for God's sakes. Mm-hmm. I mean.
I got to produce the Slip of the Tongue. And, you know, you're given like 20 tracks and a piece of paper with all the words and you get to pick each word from each track of what you liked. And then they put it together, and mix it together. It's such an amazing process.
Man.
I can only imagine on an album that big or a band that big with just the energy in the studio, like what's going on with all those great players and a guy like, was John Kolodner running around?
Okay, so John Kolodner.
Legendary A&R guy.
Legendary A&R guy. He did my True E Hollywood story. He was on it. And at the time when it came out and he said this, I was so hurt and I was so mad. But now I am so grateful that it's in the archives because it's true. He called me the Yoko Ono.
I was going to bring that up.
Oh, wow.
And at the time I was, like I said, I was really pissed. But now I can finally turn to my kids and go, look, this was true. That's true. I really was. I picked the album covers. I picked the photographers. I would go in and fight about what was the A side, what was the B side.
Yeah.
How, what the clothes were, how the look of the band was. Everything.
Wow.
But you were, it's not like you were just.
And it worked.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the results.
Creative. You were the creative. What is it?
Like, the creative consultant.
Creative consultant of Whitesnake.
But I think there was probably some resentment. Like, who's this bimbo? You know, she's just a girl in the video. What does she know about picking songs? Or, and it's like, you knew a lot.
Yes, I did. Going back to being 16 with Rob, I didn't just, you know, come off the street and didn't know my stuff.
Yeah,
it's not like you were some girl hanging out at the Rainbow with Ron Jeremy and Fig.
Could you imagine?
No, I can't, actually.
A Fig?
Fig's the guy with the purple studs with the cat on his, you know, kind of a creepy guy. But, you know, he used to have parties with Gazari and the Hills with all these young girls, and I went to one. I was fascinated. Probably small potatoes to you, but like for a kid who was a virgin to be at this party, sure. I was like, wow, this is like the half the guys looked like girls, and it was like a menu. You could just order what you wanted.
Do you
think
there's anything like that today?
I talk about this all the time. There's no era like that era. You know, you go down Sunset at night. Do you need anything?
No, I just wanted to.
Oh, please. You know, the key, well, Gazari's is now, Jay-Z bought it.
Yeah, but it's fine.
And it's just, the strip is dead.
Jay-Z bought what?
Jay-Z bought the, what was Gazari's.
Oh, did he buy that?
But so it's like a...
Isn't it the Key Club?
Wasn't was it? It was Billboard Live after Gazari's, and then the Key Club, and now it's, I forget what it's called, but it's like a ethnic like rapper... like soul type of club, and you know, it's not the same. It's just,
gosh, we just got really lucky, didn't we?
Oh, no, yeah,
it was just, it
you got lucky. Like, we were just watching, you know, like,
but yeah, you were in it.
That's, I mean, I was talking to Earl before this, and I'm like, you know, we're going to talk about the 80s and all this stuff. But the thing with Earl and I is we're such 80s fans. Like we were just growing up and watching on TV. We're watching MTV. You were there. You were in the, you know, and that's what's fascinating. But I'm like, I know she has this whole, you know, life and kids and lots of other stuff. You're a biography and are you writing a book or something? Are you doing?
I'm supposed to.
Oh, you should.
You should. The world wants to know.
I mean.
You know? Yeah. Earl wants to hear.
There's some information that I have of other people that really should be out there. And it's not anything derogatory. It's just that I happened, my life was strange enough to bump up against so many amazing people that it's really almost kind of like my duty to write a book.
Yeah. You
know? Oh, you have to.
And you'll do it delicately enough where, you know, you'll give the information, but I see that you're very sensitive and you don't want to hurt feelings or rock the boat. I can see that about you. And I think if you do it, that'll come across and you won't be judged too harshly and you'll just get your story out, you know? And maybe bring to light things that should be brought to light, whatever it be.
Like a nicer side of Rob, you know, who you just you just hear, you know, some of the, you know, maybe not so nice stories. And like toward the end, they show him on, I think they showed him in Juan Cruchet's studio, and he was, you know, it was his last solo. And, you know,
I didn't see that.
I mean, it was cool in the sense that you could tell that he was sick, but for that 2 minutes doing the solo, he was like
back
transformed back into like happier times. And like probably my favorite concert. I've been to thousands of concerts. I'm at the Troubadour one night seeing a cover band called Rat and Roll, and you know, they didn't look too much like Rat. The singer was kind of had a belly, and But he, as they're doing their encore, he says, we've played with Warren, we've played with Bobby. Well, now we get to play with our two favorites. And Juan and Robin walk out. And you could tell Robin was not necessarily sick, but maybe not in the best health. And he picked up the fake Robin's shitty out-of-tune guitar. And
was it a Flying V?
Yeah, it was a Jackson. It was a white Flying V, but this Flying V was not properly, it was not flying. It was grounded. And but it was just so neat to see him happy for like just 5 minutes, and that's
transcend.
I'll never, and Juan, you know, is just, I think your book would be nice to hear nice stories as well. And I'm sure you have gossip or dirt on other, and you have to say some of it. I mean, people like to hearing behind the wall stories that
and that David Lee Roth story is a good story. That's silly and funny, and it just people can see him do. I can see people seeing him do that, and that's funny. You know, if you have those kind of stories, that's it's silly and fun, and he wouldn't care now.
Like I read the Bobby Brown book, you know, the cherry pie girl.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And, she wrote a book.
I don't know if she wrote it. I mean, you could drive a truck through the sentences. I mean, big font. A lot of pics.
Just screaming. Oh, okay.
I mean, the lettering was about this big. And I don't know if you guys are friends, enemies. What, I don't.
Yeah, I've never met her.
I mean, she was on that show, and I'm almost positive you were asked to do this show, Rock Wives.
I wouldn't.
I know you wouldn't, but you had to have been their first choice.
I was not going to do.
I did not like I think it was Charisse Neal and some girl named Blue who was married to.
It's just.
The show was horrible.
It was a caricature of, you know, it's not. When David was done his last encore of the evening, his hair would come down, he'd put on an Armani suit, and we'd leave. Mm-hmm. You know, it wasn't crazy 24/7. Like I said, I got him at a good time. I got him when he was a grown up.
Yeah.
When he was an adult. So all this, I saw one episode where this girl, I don't even know who she was, but she got a doll made of herself or something.
Right.
One of the wives. And I was like, okay, that is, she was sending it to her husband, I guess, to be there when she couldn't be there. Mm-hmm.
Right. I mean, who wants a sex doll of their wife?
Yeah. Right.
I mean, you want a sex doll, it's going to be of your mistress.
Well, one of the things that a rule that I had on the road with Whitesnake was no women backstage, no girls ever, 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 ever.
Tommy Aldridge must have wanted to throttle you.
Well, the wives, they had a love-hate relationship with me. They loved that rule.
Right.
No groupies allowed backstage ever.
Wow, that's crazy to think that at a Whitesnake concert, you think it'd be just an ant farm of whores.
Yeah, you would. But I learned it from being on the road with Van Halen. And, you know, every night, David giving passes to his roadies. I don't know if you guys know this or not, but one of the things, or maybe I should save it for the book.
Give us a little tasty.
Okay, yeah. I'll give you a little taste. He would give his roadies each 3 passes a night, and they'd have to put their initials on it. And whatever girl he ended up with at the end of the night with the roadie's initial, he'd give them $100.
That's, you know.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, just things like that. So I saw that, and I couldn't control any of the Van Halen stuff. I wasn't, you know, I wasn't married to David, God. So when it was my turn to make the rules, I went, there will not be the women back here that there was during the Van Halen days.
Now, what about with Rat? Did that, you know, when they were first getting big, I'm sure women were starting to enter into the picture.
Women were around from the time I was 16. I mean, like I said, Rob was, he liked the girls.
Yeah.
Well, if you're that good looking, I mean.
Yeah. Well, and his charisma. I mean, you could just feel it when he walked into a room. You know who else was like that? It was Brad Pitt.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. I mean, it's Brad Pitt.
Yeah, but even he had his back to me and he was in this room and I walked in and I could just feel that somebody, there was a presence here. Mm-hmm. And then he turned around and this was like right after Thelma and Louise. So he hadn't mm-hmm. become.
Right.
And I look back now and I was like, wow.
Yeah.
You could really feel it. Mm-hmm. Certain people have that.
Oh, yeah. You either have it or you don't.
Yeah.
Right. You're either born with it or you're not.
Yeah.
Now, has the 90s come into the scene?
Yes.
I mean, Nirvana comes along.
And kills it and is signed by Geffen.
Right.
Who has Aerosmith.
Guns N' Roses.
Guns N' Roses. Whitesnake. And kills the rest of...
I mean, was there a moment when it's like... I think Warren's Cherry Pie video was like the last big video from that genre. And then I think a couple months later, the Nirvana video comes out and it's like, what? The drummer's hitting cherry pies and this guy's these rabid teen. I mean, was there a moment in time where you're like, it's over? Not, mm-hmm. I mean, just for the genre, not for you, but like.
Yes. And I got out before then. So I was, you know, I moved on to another chapter in my life.
Well, for sure.
So I was grateful because that must have been really, it was hard to watch. Mm-hmm. So it must have been felt really mm-hmm. bad to be in that.
Yeah,
all of a sudden you're not relevant anymore. That music mm-hmm. couldn't.
Almost overnight.
Almost overnight.
I remember.
The only people who really survived that was Guns N' Roses. Mm-hmm.
And they were kind of like, a lot of people don't realize they were somewhat glam like before they had made it. You know, if you look at pictures of Axl, he looks like Bret Michaels when he was like...
Right. And Poison was with Geffen?
Yeah. I mean, or I thought Poison was with Capitol.
Poison was managed by Howard Kaufman, who managed...
Okay.
That's where... I got confused.
No, listen.
Poison was with... They signed with our management.
I mean, Poison... they just... blew up out of nowhere and they hit it right. I mean, they were like one of the last Mohicans. Cinderella was right. And then Warren had
loved Cinderella.
Oh yeah,
they're so good. I mean, you know, that video they did with Little Richard is just Shelter Me, and Little Richard's in it. His voice, I don't know how he sings like that for 30 years. Yeah. I mean, and they still perform and are great. And
I want to go to these concerts, but I'm so
we're taking
afraid.
You. Well, you would be mobbed. You couldn't go.
I'm afraid. Yeah.
Because you look the same.
I don't. Well, thank you.
You really do.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I thought he said you love to sing. I'm like, you love to sing?
I do, and he's
like,
No, I mean, I swear to God, you look the same that you did in Bachelor Party. I mean, Botox, Schmotox.
I'm loving the red. I love the red hair. Yay. Yeah.
I mean, some people from that era have not held up. That's why it's sad when I go see these concerts.
I think probably because there were a lot of drugs and there were a lot of alcohol, and that stuff really ages you.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I see Rudy Sarzo. He looks pretty good.
Yeah, Rudy looks good.
I mean,
good.
He looks great. You know, I'm trying to think.
But you can see the wear in like Steven's face. No, not Steven Pearce.
Steven Tyler.
Mm-hmm. You know, although I think I've always been a huge fan. Mm-hmm. I love them. I remember they opened for us in Japan. But I remember Aerosmith from like seventh grade.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And they were like my idols. Mm-hmm. And here we were, and they were opening for us.
Yeah.
Because they were.
Oh my God.
I mean, that's like.
Because they've gone.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then when they did that rap song, they
that brought them back. Yeah.
And then they had Desmond Child just start penning their hits. And I mean, I would love to see Desmond Child's publishing, but. You know.
He stopped doing drugs a long time ago, though, right?
Well, I'm not sure about that.
Or does he not?
Steven Tyler?
Yeah.
Oh, he goes in and out. Okay. But you know what? He goes out. So that's good.
Yeah, I mean.
I
Just this get a whole blood transfusion and you're good.
Yeah, yeah, just, you know, dialysis.
Rolling yeah. Stones. He was the first one to do that.
Keith Richards. Yeah, I think he went to Sweden yeah. three times yeah. a year.
Got his blood cleaned. I mean,
it's amazing.
If you're not hurting anybody else,
yeah, yeah.
Oh, sure.
Go for it. Yeah. Do what. If you, as long as you're not my kid.
Yeah. Oh, of course. Do you keep a? I mean, must. How hard is it to have kids today, like with all the creepy crawlers and, you know, back in the 80s, there was no Facebook or Twitter. So,
texting,
you know,
and cell phones.
Well, my kids, they're already predisposed to it because of their mom. So if I tag them in a picture, they'll get thousands of people. Mm-hmm. Following them yeah. or asking them to be friends.
Yeah.
And they're like, Mom, don't tag me anymore. Like,
yeah.
So they don't just let anybody on to their,
wow.
to their page. It's interesting dynamic.
That is interesting.
Because on one hand, they don't think I've done anything in my life. And on the other hand, they're like, don't tag me because thousands of people try to be my friend.
Yeah. That's a big deal.
I wonder when they're going to reconcile, when those two are going to meet, when they're going to reconcile it and go, yeah, okay. I said to my daughter just yesterday, she's in Australia doing her second semester. And I said, there's going to come a time when you're going to want your daughter to think that you're a woman too.
Right.
Because you have to be their mother, and you can't, because once that bell is unrung, mm-hmm. you can't go back. So, mm-hmm. and they have a million friends, but they only have one
mom. Yeah.
But when they get older, they don't need the parenting so much. They need your wisdom.
Yes.
And your advice. And you have to know when to give it and when not to. So my daughter and I were yesterday texting about her upcoming birthday. She's going to be 21. And the texting stopped when she said, I can't wait to get back to America and go to Vegas, which I responded, oh my God, I'd love to go with you. Boom. There was no response. Yeah. Because I'm her mom.
Yeah.
So I texted her back and I said, I go, Chris Kardashian, and that's like the F word in our house, right?
Ugh, yeah. Gross.
You can't whore your kids out. Hangs out with her older daughters, whether you like it or not, whether we like it or not, she mm-hmm. does, but she can't with the young ones because they're not mature enough yet to know that she had a life, that mm-hmm. she is a person. She's their mom.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to make that transition yourself and figure out, you know, when you're supposed to be their mom and when you can hang.
Yeah.
But you made all the men in your life better.
Mm-hmm.
Chris Kardashian has turned Bruce Jenner, an Olympic icon, into this bumbling baboon.
It's, yeah.
Well, I think he did it to himself a little bit too, because I have watched that show. I used to watch it here a lot just because I just did. I don't know why. And then I stopped watching for a long time, and then I started watching again, and he's like wants a different Adam's apple thing, and he's growing his hair long, and he wants to do all this stuff. They're not together anymore.
Yeah, but they're forced.
So he's kind of a weirdo all by himself.
But I wonder if he, like, the seeds were planted
because of her.
Because of her.
And her crazy.
Women, we really do have an effect on our men.
Mm. Oh, absolutely.
Oh, gosh. Okay. This is where the tables turn.
Yeah. No, this is now the Tawny show. Inappropriate Tawny.
So did you have a good chemistry with Tom Hanks? And or did you guys ever, like... You never, like, hooked up with Tom Hanks back in the day? No? Okay.
Because
you guys had such a good chemistry on that show. I mean, Earl and I will talk about each other. We can. But I still really wanted to know that, you know, because you guys were so good in that movie. I'm just saying.
You know what? It never even came to my mind. Is that weird?
Yeah.
The thought never even occurred to me to even try.
Mm-hmm.
Because you were too, you were a serious actress. I mean, you know, it was like.
Yeah, he was, this was work.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. That's good.
Now, do you ever see the guy who played Kent in Bachelor Party, who I thought, the blonde guy with the, he was in love with you throughout the whole movie. Oh, Robert Prescott?
Boyfriend?
Yeah. He was hilarious.
Yes. I haven't seen him. Mm-mm.
Now, I've often wondered this. Like, if you saw Adrian Smed at Gelson's, would you say hello to him?
Yes.
Like, when you worked with, I mean, when you worked with them, and, but you haven't seen them in 20, you would say, hey, what's happening?
Correct. Yes. Yeah.
I'm obsessed with Adrian Smed.
Are you?
But that's,
I don't know. Who is
he was the Tom Hanks' buddy, his best buddy, always trying to, like, get him in trouble and...
You
know,
oh, okay.
Good-looking guy,
little dreamer. That guy.
Yeah, yeah. He was the host of Dance Fever after.
Yeah.
Jenny Terrio.
Oh
I'm in love with a little dreamer.
I think he got to sleep with Merv Griffin as a benefit of that show, which is fine. I mean,
whatever floats your boat.
Hey, it's not. I mean, I live on Larrabee, so this boat is floating constantly.
Yeah.
So what do you? You know, you go on your IMDb page, you've got a lot of stuff in the 90s and 2000s and currently. What is there any like big projects you're working on right now that you can divulge?
I just finished a film. It's called Come See Me.
Right.
But it's spelled S-I-M-I for Simi Valley.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a true story about two sisters. And I play the sister that she's a porno actress. At 40, she decided to get into the MILF category.
Because right.
I guess that's when the whole MILF thing started.
Absolutely.
And her sister is a real actress. And she would tell everybody that she was selling like Herbalife and diet teas, and she was a masseuse, and her whole family and everybody knew that she was doing porno. But you didn't see that side of,
right.
I didn't play that.
Mm-hmm.
That's just the background when they would talk about my character.
Mm-hmm.
Well, why don't you bring your sister in on that?
Yeah.
They would bring up my character. So you never saw that part. You saw, I played, her name's Dee Dee. And I go with my sister to help get our mother out of a rest home.
Okay.
And it's all these, you know.
That's awesome.
To us.
Now, will that be in theaters or like Netflix?
Yeah,
or?
There were so many wonderful actors that did cameos. What's her name? Jada, the girl from Parks and Rec.
Okay.
She played a Jamaican nurse.
Okay.
So we had, Arrested Development, the dad. Oh, gosh. I love him. Jason Bateman's dad.
Right.
He was always a dream of mine to work with, like Paul Giamatti. He plays the OnStar voice in the car.
Okay.
In this direction. So it's a bunch of really wonderful people in this movie.
Yeah.
They're editing, going through.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And I think you did was it a Law and Order or CSI?
CSI.
How was that?
It was great because it was the same CSI that Justin Bieber had done.
Oh,
okay.
So that's when my, she was 12 at the time, went, oh my gosh.
Oh, wow.
Mom, you might be kind of cool. Justin Bieber did that.
Yeah.
So I got
some. I need to talk to your kids.
Yeah.
I really do. Yeah. I should, you should give me their Facebook and I'll just be like, look, I just got to let you know that she was the coolest and is the coolest. And she's your mom and you should embrace it.
Yeah.
The 80s.
Ask me about my life.
Yeah.
I mean, we grew up with Rat, Whitesnake. They're growing up with Justin Bieber. And
yeah. It was the greatest time. I know it was just my like childhood, but it was the greatest time. The music, MTV,
the movies,
home box office. You know, I remember watching cable and remember when HBO would fly, and you just get so excited to watch movies. I was so excited to watch movies back then. You know,
you did that
16 can. Yeah, yeah. It just would fly out
and over the city.
You know. And 16 Candles was on like all the time.
They don't make movies like Bachelor Party anymore.
Yeah,
they're just,
they're the greatest.
No, they make games. They make movies like Hunger Games and
all the shitty CGI. And,
The movies I like. Enough said.
Right.
So great.
Oh well, I see. I win. Yeah. Win. Whatever it fucking takes.
Whatever
it fucking takes. Yeah. It's a good movie. Gotta see it. Win. Look it up.
Well, I'll see that if you see RoboCop.
Oh man, I saw the one from 80.
What?
Did really?
Did you? Awful. Okay, I thought.
Isn't that? Oh yeah.
They used no one from the original movie.
No, but that was the guy back to
Peter Weller.
Here we go again. The lead actor. He was in the fight with Christian, who won the. Best Supporting Actor, The Fighter, Mark Wahlberg.
Right.
Thank you.
Christian Bale, Mark Wahlberg.
Wasn't he in RoboCop?
The new one?
Yeah.
No, it was a very unknown cast for the most part.
Okay. Mark Wahlberg has a new movie coming out. It's Transformers.
Oh.
Right. Yeah. That's I haven't seen. I was such a
RoboCop kind of like that.
I was just not very.
Not a girl.
I mean, definitely not a girl movie. Yeah.
I'm not an action film person, so
it would. Make her have to watch RoboCop before you see a movie with really good acting and dialogue.
The first movie we saw together was Die Hard 4, and
which was an awful movie.
Yeah, I've fallen asleep. I just can't. I can't get into it.
We had different tastes in movies.
Yes.
But I would let her watch her shows like Snapped.
Oh yeah, yeah.
These crazy shows about the wives killing the husbands.
Yeah.
And great, you know, show. I watched the UFC and the violent stuff, and you
I think
know,
that's pretty much. I think that's probably most of us.
Yeah.
I mean,
we take
ESPN
turns.
Theme was a constant in my house in the 90s.
Well, but that's because you were dating a baseball, like a
married.
Right.
How long were you married for?
We dated from 1999 to 2002. And then subsequent years. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, was it?
So that's a long time. It's been 24 years.
And do you still talk to him?
I mean, lunch with him tomorrow.
Oh, wow. Cool. Now, what's it like going from the rock world to, I mean, baseball players are, I guess you could say, rock stars in their world? Is it a different kind of energy? I mean, there's no backstage, but.
There's no backstage, but there are groupies, and the groupies are. 1,000 times worse.
Wow.
I've been married to both. I've been married to a rock star and an athlete. And the groupies, I would pick the rock star groupies any day of the week.
Oh,
because
wow.
They just want one thing. They just want a notch on their lipstick case. Mm-hmm. The athlete groupies want that paycheck.
Yeah.
Right.
They want to get knocked up. So they're... They're so much more dangerous.
Wow.
And I mean,
and they're real.
Oh, I can imagine. I mean, you must have been a big hit in the clubhouse from the standpoint of kids just coming up to the big team were like fans of, you know, the rock and roll scene. So they were like, oh my God, that's the girl from the Whitesnake videos. And I mean, that must have been a neat feeling to have all these young, like, you know, not in nothing in a sexual way, but just like, you were a huge celebrity to them. I mean, it must have been an empowering feeling. Or what, maybe not.
I've kind of always, it never hit me.
Right.
Because I've been doing this for so long that it wasn't, I didn't feel empowered. I just felt like me again.
Right.
You know, does that make any sense?
Oh, for sure.
But there, it was much more difficult for me because I wasn't allowed to go in and change their uniforms.
Right.
I wasn't allowed to.
Tell them what pitch is to throw.
Well, yeah. I could tell you what pitch he was throwing or give a suggestion.
Right.
He should throw depending on who was on.
Sure.
You know, and it's a really fascinating game. A lot of people think it's boring, but it's, I love baseball. I mean, when you really, really know the game.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, I'm more of a hockey guy, but it's just it's instant action.
Right.
I mean, I love baseball when a home run or...
I love But well, it's more. Yeah. It's so much. It's a mental. It's a really strong mental.
Oh, for sure. Now, was it when he would lose? I mean, did he ever take same. Right? That's
whether
great.
He won or he lost. Same demeanor.
Because that's a lot of, you know, being the pitcher, it's like being the quarterback.
He's the captain of the team.
You know, you have a great game. Singer. Yeah.
He's the lead singer, but in a different, what's it called? Career.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's being a pitcher, like, if you have a great game, you get all the credit. If the team gets killed,
it's your fault.
You suck. I mean, that must be, I mean, in the critics in baseball, very guys who've never played the game are like, well, Chuck Finley had a should have thrown a fastball when he threw it. And it's like, you never even played kickball.
Right. Mm-hmm. Monday morning quarterbacks.
What do you think was worse? Like when he would get criticized for not having a good game, or when David or Rob would, this album sucks. You know how hard it is to make an album. You think rock critics are the worst or the sports critics?
Sports.
Why do you say that?
Because for someone like myself who can produce but can't play,
right.
I can hear the notes. I know, but I can't throw 99 miles an hour.
Right.
So it's harder for me to judge that.
Sure.
So I think sports critics, because if you've never played and you're sitting there and you're taking shots at these guys.
Yeah, I can't. That drives me up a wall.
Yeah.
Like, you know, but it's the same in the rock world. Like, you know, with the Hall of Fame selections, you know, some bands don't get in.
Well, that's just commercial, right?
I mean, it's like you see, you know, Rush. I think they just got in with Kiss, actually. And it's like, how did, like, certain bands get in before Kiss? And you know, how are the Cars not in it, but yet the Dave Clark Five is in. It's like,
this is a Dave Clark Five.
They're like a big band in the 50s, yeah. But you know, it's like they're so political, it seems.
Right.
Like Whitesnake is probably like on the fence of ever getting in. It's like, they are great. I mean,
that's funny. There's a Hall of Fame for baseball and there's a Hall of Fame for, you're right.
Yeah. I mean, it's just so weird, their selection process. And like, you know, Rat would probably not get in. And it's
no,
like,
they wouldn't, I don't think.
Just because they...
the album sells, they'd probably...
I think the Rolling Stones...
right.
Or the Rolling Stone basically selects the Hall of Fame. The owner, Jan Werner, and he doesn't like bands like Rat and Whitesnake. It seems kind of unfair. Like in sports, if you're a great player, you're going to get in. If you have 300 wins or...
Right.
Barry Bonds will get in. Maybe not because he did all the steroids, but
has Rat had any hit albums? Like,
oh yeah, he had five in a row
back in the day. But like
recently, well, I know John Kolodner in like '99 tried to start a label called Portrait, where he had like Rat and Cinderella and a few other bands from that era, and it didn't maybe go so well. You know, I think Stephen Pierce, he's like, he tried to make a sound like the Cars, and you know. But, you know, they're still touring.
Yeah.
I think they have the guitar player from Quiet Riot, Carlos Cavazo, play Robin's parts. And he's pretty good. I mean, it's not the same.
Who are they out with?
You know, they pretty much go out on their own and play like House of Blues type of venues. And I think they're doing, I think their next gig is something called the Monsters of Rock Cruise. And,
oh, I think I heard about that. That's when I went, oh, I want to go, but I'm so scared.
Oh, my God. You would get, you'd have to, like, show up in blackface or something. I mean.
Walking with all those bodyguards like Justin Bieber down in Florida or wherever he was.
Yeah, I mean, I would.
All the girls were swarming around him.
I mean, I would love to.
She could get you could do appearances at those kind of places and make some money. I don't know if that would be your deal, but. I mean, people are still
my kids.
Yeah, but people are still very interested in seeing you, especially at all. And there's so many of those kind of concerts and stuff that are going on.
Where you
could
just
be like, you should talk to people and just be like, hey, are people wanting to see me? Of course they are.
DMC.
Yeah, like
fans coming out.
You know, just yes, host, host. Why not MC? Like, you look great. You should do it.
Sure.
You yeah. should get your managers, agents, whatever, and host some of these rock shows.
Yeah, we'll do comedy.
I'll do 20 minutes.
She'll do 20.
I can be clean. I'll be dirty, whatever. I can do whatever.
You host, and I'll sell the t-shirts.
That's
no, but
good.
Seriously, you should be like, and tell your kids like, hey, this is what's paying for college, even though right. the other stuff's probably paying for college, but or
baseball Hall of Fame.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. Good. Well, you know,
go Chuck, get in there.
Yeah. Or just like, mom wants to be creative, and this, you know, I just want to be creative. This is something I want to do. This is something I have an interest in. Hmm. Right?
Oh, absolutely. You and know? Before we go on,
it's your soul. You should do what your soul
yeah,
wants.
I've been kind of.
You have been.
You should.
Your hair's red, and you gotta show the world, you know. And it looks great, and you look great, and you should. That would be so cool. I think that would be so cool.
I think you two are gonna be besties. I just there's an energy.
Well, when I was a kid, when I was in seventh grade, people used to always say that you look like the girl in the Whitesnake videos. And I remember my friend Amy Salino, I'll never forget it. She's like, you look like her, but you don't have her body. I'm like, thanks, Amy Salino. You know, like I'm in seventh grade going through my awkward phase too. Like, leave me alone, growing up. But I was always told that. And then when I saw you at the Comedy Store, that was so cool because David Taylor's like, you're going to meet Tawny. I'm like, oh my God. And that was just the coolest thing, going to the back room.
When you were holding court. I mean,
yeah.
Was I?
Word was spreading. Like, I got like 8 phone calls. Earl, you got to get down here. I thought, who is Wayne Gretzky there? They're like, no, Tawny Katane. I'm like, Tawny Katane. I was breaking every speed record to get there.
I actually walked by you maybe like a week or two before. I was walking up because it's where we hang. And I was walking up and I walked past you and I went and I saw Earl and I'm like, I walked in, I'm like, Tawny Katane was just on. He's like, oh yeah, she's been here all night. I'm like, oh. And I was like, I want to go up and talk to her, but I know she's going to be like, don't annoy me, you know? So then when I found out that you've been hanging out up there, I was like, oh, I got to meet her. And so that was so cool. That was like one of the coolest moments for me. I ran up to you. I'm like, I love you. Like, I love you and I've always loved you. And look, we look alike. Don't we look alike? You know, I remember your friends are like, you do look alike. And I'm like, I know. So,
I mean, there are
cool moments.
A lot of celebrities who go up there and no one gives a shit.
Yeah.
You know, the other night, Donovan McNabb, the football player, was up there and no one paid any attention to him. He was quiet, but when you were up there, everyone wanted to meet you.
Yeah.
Like, it was like, you know, and then you went to Dave Taylor's barbecue and it was like, you were like, there was a line to greet you.
Yeah.
And Dave Taylor, I must thank for arranging this.
Yes. Thank you, David Taylor.
David, I
rock.
David.
I do too.
When he green lights something, I do it.
Yeah.
If he says no, I don't do it.
Yeah.
He's like my manager.
Oh, yeah. Sure.
Yeah. And he's very smart, so he knows.
I love that man.
Yeah, I love him too.
And it really was true. All those things happened that day.
Seriously?
I swear.
Happened?
The iPod, the Gardels, I stopped dead in my tracks. And then Mr. Clark, who's the sweetest guy, I'm like, this is a sign. I need to reach out to Tawny. Dave Taylor knows her. And then, you know, he arranged it. And, you know, I'm sure you get asked to do a lot of these wacky podcasts and radio shows. And I'm sure the host intentions are to make fun of you or like bring up the bad stuff, you know, just like, oh, we're better than you. We are so honored to have you here.
Yes.
And we just love you to death. Even in messaging with you, I felt like just like a friendship with you. And it's like, I don't even know that. I mean, she doesn't even know who I am. And you're being so nice and like, you know.
And I don't see a lot of bad. I don't see any bad stuff. I see all good stuff.
Oh, we do. But you know, these you've been on radio shows where, you know, even back in the day when Rat and Whitesnake and
Howard Stern.
Right. Yeah. Tony, tell us.
Was Howard mean?
Howard. What?
It's a tough.
Howard's the nicest guy.
Yeah.
And that's really true. You could tell when you were back on the air.
Yeah.
With Howard. During the commercial breaks, he's so soft and so gentle. And then, boom, that personality comes out.
Yeah, yeah,
like,
yeah.
Oh, we must be live.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, okay. So. But he was always really kind to me.
Yeah.
He'd have to do his certain shtick, but he was always nice.
Okay.
Very respectful.
I like Howard Stern.
Yeah. Yeah. And when people think that they're going to do that, I show up when I, if I show up, if I want to, and they, I, they kind of disarm and they don't really take shots at me.
Mm-hmm. Well, cause you're a strong woman and that's intimidating to like some guy who probably thinks I'm going to crack on this girl and make fun of the, whatever they're going to make fun of. And you don't take any shit.
Yeah.
So you remind me a lot of Gail. Gail reminds me a lot of you. I mean, you girls are strong women. Which is why I fold in front of you guys.
As well you should.
Because I'm kind of a puss, but...
Nah.
You know.
You're tough.
Oh, yeah, I'm tough, you know, when I have to be. And,
I saw at the Comedy Store, we throw menus at people when they're on stage just to be funny, and someone got Earl in the eye.
Someone hit me in the...
Threw the mic down, and it's like you see this total different side. I'm like...
It's like the Incredible Hulk.
Yeah. That's exactly what it's like. I'm like, oh my God, Earl never gets mad.
Well, I don't know if they have a ritual in the rock and roll world and pranks, and, you know, maybe putting shit in some guy's guitar case. But at the Comedy Store, they throw stuff at you if they like you.
Yeah.
If they don't like you, they just don't talk to you. Like if Dave Taylor doesn't like you, he just walks away.
Oh, I would imagine.
Yeah. Well, he does the thing because he's so tall where you'd be like, hi, Dave. And you look at him, he pretends he just doesn't see you. He just walks over you and goes, and he showed me, he's like, watch. He's like, he did it for me. He's like, this is how I ignore people. He's like, just walk up to me and say hi to me. And he's so tall. And I went, hi, Dave. And he just like hovered over me. Like he couldn't see me. He's so funny.
And he'll give you one verbal shot. If you were on fire, I would not piss on you.
Yeah. He called me up on stage one time. Do you know that?
No.
Yeah.
And did you go up?
Oh my gosh. I almost ended the friendship. I was like, don't ever do that to me again. You guys, I did not know you couldn't see the audience.
Yeah.
That light is so bright. It's
very bright.
You can't see anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And us out there, we think you guys can see us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As the audience, we think you guys can see us. And he calls me. He tells everybody that I'm in the audience. And I'm like turning into my kids where they like go underneath the furniture. Mm-hmm. And so then it was like this whole, come on, clap, 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 clap. And I felt like I would be, that would just be so mean. I was like, no. And then you have to. You have to go up where you just look like.
Dave's very powerful.
He's powerful.
Yeah.
And so I went up there and he interviewed me on the stage and brought up things that you guys were kind enough to not go.
Oh, yeah. Please.
And I'm like, David.
No, I'm not. Yeah.
Stop it.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, my goal is to get you to come back. And, I mean, you know, I know.
And David did do that to me, and we are still great friends.
Oh, yeah. Dave's the best. So, he's like a.
I love him.
Yeah.
I just wish he was a multi-millionaire.
He will be. And him and Ashley will work out their things.
I want those two to work it out.
Yeah.
They will. They're just meant, you know.
She loves you guys, by the way.
Yeah, I love Ashley.
Oh, Ashley's always been nice to me and thinks Gail's beautiful.
Yeah.
And,
She does. She she does. And she's so beautiful, too.
Yeah.
Well,
she's a great girl.
Yeah. I mean, I don't want to keep. We're already at an hour and 40 minutes.
Yeah. Are we?
I mean. We just love having you here.
The 90s, yeah.
Well, that's we're going to have... This is the 80s only podcast. Okay. I mean, if you would be so kind and humble to come back at your leisure, we would love to... Because you're more than just the 80s.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Know, I mean... Like I said, go on IMDb, look up Tawny Kitaen, and you're like, wow, she's tons of things in the 2000s.
So Seinfeld.
Seinfeld.
Married with Children.
Yeah. I mean,
Hercules.
With Kevin Sorbo.
Kevin Sorbo.
I mean, we'll get to him, you know, later. And, you know, we just think so highly of you, Tawny. We can't thank you enough.
Thank you. So thank you. It's an honor.
Do you have any, do you want your fans to contact you in any, or my fans? Gail's fans, are you on Twitter? Or
I am on Twitter. Someone stole my name. So I'm Tawny underscore Kitaen.
Tawny underscore.
Underscore.
And underscore. You don't do Facebook or...
There's quite a few pages that aren't me. So mm-hmm. I Instagram.
Do you want to give that out or do you want to keep that?
It's Tawny Katane.
Okay. Yeah. I guess I didn't know if people use like weird names like Wacky Tawny.
There are.
All right. Well,
I got my name on that.
We're going to have you back when you're in this neck because we appreciate you driving. You're in the 714.
949.
Nine, that's even farther.
Is it?
Yeah. I think.
714 go between 949 and.
I think 949 is beyond 714.
It's before 619.
Right. That's San Diego.
People on the East Coast are going, what the
People heck on this are podcast are like, what are these? Yeah, what is this? Skull and Bones?
818-213.
Well, basically, what I'm trying to say to you guys in the podcast land is Tawny drove a long fucking way to do this. And we hope she does it again so we can talk about the 90s, 2000, and beyond.
Yes.
Tawny Katane. We love you.
Thank you so much for having
MC.
Me.
MC.
You're the best. This will be on iTunes and SoundCloud. Inappropriate Earl with the one, the only, the icon, Tawny Katane. Woo.